page 359 in your United Methodist handbook. In addition, from 7:28 to 8:01, again,
It's okay. She will be attending the Black Clergy Women of the United Methodist Church Conference in New Orleans. We pray for renewal and restoration for our pastor during her time away, traveling blessings, and a fruitful conference. The Resilience Center, the Food Bank, there are volunteer opportunities each Wednesday and Fridays of every week. On Wednesdays, help is needed to prepare and pack food bags. On Fridays, help is needed at 11:30 to prepare for the 1 o'clock food distribution. The Cooling Center, as you know, is open through September. It's Monday through Friday, noon to 8. Ministry funding partnership, the Flavors Food Truck is on campus Monday through Saturday, 11 to 8 p.m. and Sundays from 11 o'clock to 8 p.m. For all of those who want to grab our lunch or our dinner, that means no cooking.
He'll be here today.
And he will be here today. Praise the Lord, his vehicle was fixed. And back to school drive, we will be collecting school supplies to support our local school, specifically Ms. Kirkendall's class. We will have more information coming soon. Wesley Incessory Prayer, 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. August the 12th, the Ways of the Leader. And August 13th will be Wesley Leadership Board Meeting. The 2024 Leadership Board Board Meeting schedule is as follows: September, October, November, and December. Every Wednesday, prayer call, 8 a.m. Our numbers are listed for us, how to call in, and the code in which you must click in. Everyone is invited to Wednesday morning prayer time to lift up your prayer concerns and to receive strength from the word to carry you throughout the week. And in the front of our bulletin on page 2, we have listed the many ways in which you can give. We have Tithely and we have Zelle. If you are like me and my phone is usually attached to me, these are quite convenient ways. I will be passing the plate as well. So we shan't forget that. Prayers and concerns for the body of Christ and the world. During your personal worship time, please pray for those listed in your bulletin, those that you know that may keep it to themselves, lift them up in prayer. Keep our East District in your prayers as well as they keep us in their prayers. Our care team is led by Robert Miller and Mrs. Zeta Bay. Let them know. If you'd like to be a part of that team, they call, they offer encouragement, they lift up prayers, they put a smile on someone's face, and they let people know that someone does care, and they represent us. So if we do not individually call them, Mr. Miller and Ms. Bay represent Wesley as a whole as well. If you'd like to join them, please contact them to let them know that you're interested in being a part of the care team. DSC Advanced Lay Servant Class. The class offering is lay pastoral caregiving. It will be Friday, September the 20th from 6 p.m. to 9 p.m. and Saturday, September the 21st from 9 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. They will hold the class at Dump of the Desert United Methodist Church in Glendale, Arizona. This course offers insight into the lifespan and the dynamics of contemporary life to help church leaders reach out with God's love and care to others. The participants will need a text called Lay Personal Caregiving. You are required to read the text prior to the course starting. The cost for the course is $15 and is payable upon registration. You can register and pay online. If paying by cash or check, please bring it with you to the class and give it to the instructor. That concludes the announcements I have. Are there any others?
Yes. I want to share with you all, if some of you haven't already noticed, Mr. Miller isn't here today. He's having some issues with his car. He is well. He's just having some issues with his car, and so we want to keep him lifted up in prayer that that gets rectified. And per our website, hello, Miss Luella. She is online and she let us know that she is dealing with COVID. And so we want to lift her up in prayer and she recovers from COVID. Is your hand raised, Daniel?
Yes.
Yes, Daniel.
This is my chip for 30 years sobriety by the grace of God yesterday.
Hey! Allow you that space to honor God in the way you know how to honor God. Amen?
Amen.
All right, let's prepare our hearts and minds for the Word of God.
I will be reading from the Old Testament, 2 Samuel, chapter 7, verses 1 through 14. In your pew Bible, you can find that on page 281. God's covenant with David. Now when the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See, now I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Whenever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, to be prince over my people Israel, And I have been with you wherever you went, and have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more, and evildoers shall afflict them no more as formerly. From the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel, and I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house. When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your ancestors, I will rise up your offspring after you, who shall come forth from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me. When he commits inequity, I will punish him with a rod such as mortals use, with blows inflicted by human beings. The Old Testament reading can be found in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 through 22. And that can be found on page 192 in the Old Testament. New Testament. Page 192. One in Christ. So then, remember that at one time you Gentiles by birth, called the uncircumcision by those who are called the circumcision, a physical circumcision made in the flesh by human hands. Remember that you were at that time without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and as strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace, and in his flesh he has made both groups into one and has broken down the dividing wall, that is, the hostility between us. He has abolished the law with its commandments and ordinances, that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body, through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him, both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together spiritually into a dwelling place of God. The word of God to the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
bring the shawl, we need that, bring it. Come on, guys.
This one.
Don't be shy, y'all know y'all not shy.
Ralph Roger's shy.
You might be right, that's true, you're not. All right, guys, remember you were up here with me before?
Mm-hmm. We talked somebody
else. Yep, but for the other young lady named Jasmine.
I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was the name.
See, you're not shy. All right, and so we're going to take this time right here to talk about how God says that it is really important for us to rest. Do you like to sleep and take a nap?
Mm-hmm.
What about you?
I don't really.
You don't take nap? No, well, yeah, not a
lot. Sometimes I take naps when I like to. I take naps because I like getting rest and I get more energy to play around.
Now, this is why you need more energy. Can you imagine how much energy he's got right now? But you guys, so as you have your shawls that your grandma gave you, right? So when you go to sleep at night, do you cuddle up in your blanket or in your sheets so that you can make sure that you get warm, right? And then sometimes when you get in the bed, isn't it a little cold and you gotta squirm around until your body heat makes the bed warm, and then you go off to sleep? And so then while you're sleeping, what do you think is happening while you're sleeping?
You mean, what are we dreaming about?
Well, what is your body doing?
What is my body doing?
Well, it's getting comfortable. That's what I like to do. I love getting comfortable.
All right, getting comfortable. What do you think your body's doing while you're sleeping? Resting? Oh, that's what's up, brother. You got his back. You're a big brother. You're a good big brother. So while you're sleeping at night, everybody is resting, right? And so all those parts of your body that was really tired, sometimes your brain is really tired, sometimes your body is really tired, and when you go to sleep, all of that gets rest. And when you wake up in the morning, like you said, you have energy, you feel so much better. Right?
Sometimes my body just shuts off when I lay in the bed.
Right? Because you're tired, right? Especially with all the energy you have, you're just tired. And so Jesus says to us that it is really important for us to make sure that we rest so that our bodies can be refilled again so we can do all the things we enjoy doing the next day. Okay? So when it's time to go to bed, I don't want you guys fussing.
I don't want to go to bed.
Because now you know when you go to bed, one, you're going to be comfortable, like you said, and two, your body is going to be refreshed and renewed and rejuvenated and rested so that you can be full of energy like a superhero the next day. All right? So grandma, when they go to bed tonight, remind them so that they don't give you any hard times, right? Right? Not gonna give grandma. Oh, remember, you're going to bed to rest because Jesus says we must rejuvenate ourselves every day. Okay? Okay?
Okay.
Why y'all get quiet on me? All right.
Remember, I was getting a little nervous.
All right. Big brother looking out for little brother. Go ahead. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we give you praise. on this day. Praise that you continue to bless us. Praise that you continue to make ways out of no way. Praise, God, that even when we can't see, you see. And so, God, as we open up our hearts to give unto you today, we pray, God, that what we give will increase, will be a double portion. God, that you would multiply it for your ministry, that you would fill this place with your presence. God, we know that without you, we can do nothing. We also know, God, that when we're tired, we can't do much. And so, God, as we give unto you today, let this portion of our expression of praise and thanks glorify you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Our ushers will be coming down the middle aisle and will receive your offerings from you as we sing and thanks.
Oh,
gracious God, as I stand behind this holy desk, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Renewal and wholeness.
Yes.
Mark 6, verses 30 through 34, and then picking up at 53 and 56. The New Revised Standard Version reads, the apostle gathered around Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. He said to them, come away to a deserted place all by yourself and rest a while. For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went away in the boat to a deserted place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized them, and they hurried there on foot from all the towns and arrived ahead of them. As he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. 53. When they had crossed over, they came to the land of Gennesaret. When they had crossed over, they came to this land. They secured the boat. When they got out of the boat, the people at once recognized him and rushed about the whole region and began to bring the sick on mats and wherever they heard he was. And wherever he went, into the villages, the cities, the farms, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and begged him that he might touch them, even the fringes of his cloak. And all who touched it were healed. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. How many of you have siblings? And as parents have multiple children, do you remember the time when you get in the back of the car and have no choice but to touch each other, and then they start screaming, they touched me, she's touching me, mom, he touching me, or she's touching me. And then they will do the thing where they get this close to your face, I'm not touching you, mom, he's touching me, right? All of that. Can you imagine? That's how we feel, and some of us even now don't like to be touched. Some of you, I have to wrestle to get a hug. I gotta wrestle you and hold on to you just to keep you in place to get a hug from you, because you don't like to be touched even still. But can you imagine what's happening to Jesus in these stories that we're reading in the Bible today? It says that there was a multitude. They saw where he was going and hurried ahead of him. They took the shortcut and ran and got there. That when he got off the boat, they was already there like, what's up, Jesus? Touch me. Or let me touch you.
Yes.
And he did not turn them away. He didn't say, don't touch me. He didn't scream, my God, they touching me. He didn't do that. He just let them touch him. And they were all healed.
Jesus said to his disciples on the previous text ahead of that, he had sent out the disciples and he sent them out two by two and told them to go minister, right? And so this is their test. This was their internship, right? And so he sends them out and they go and they are ministering. They are healing people. They are doing the work of God. And they were doing it so much so that they couldn't even eat. The need is great, right? And so they're out there and they come back and they're all excited. You know, you get home and you're like, Mom, this is what happened today at school. And I did this and I did that. And this happened and I healed this one and I healed that one. And then they came back with their sister and brother and I healed them too. I mean, can you imagine? His ears, they just going. And there's 12 of them. And they're just going and going. I did this and I did this and we healed this and we healed that. And they're all excited. And that's adrenaline. But you know when your adrenaline gets going and but you're exhausted. And if you stop, you know you're going to pass out. Yes. And so Jesus, aware of this, says to them, go off to a place and rest.
Yes.
And rest. We are in the microwave age where we want it right now. Hopefully we're shifting to the air fryer age. It takes a whole lot better. It does take a little longer, but it's still quick. But we are the microwave age where we want what we want and we want it now. And we don't want to hear any excuses about that. I said I want it now, and we want it now. We're also the generation that coined the phrase workaholics.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you for the confirmation. We coined the word workaholics. And so everything that we do, we just keep going until it's done, and we think that if we just keep going, we can get it done. Even though we know that there's going to be more on our desk the next day.
Yes.
And then there's going to be more on our desk the next day. And that's endless. It just keeps going. But for some reason, we feel like we can just keep going. We can just keep going. And you know what? Sometimes on the pastors, they just think we can just keep going. We just keep going, Pastor. Like, y'all on vacation, and I better be here. Y'all went to three vacations, then. Pastor better be there when I get back. That's the expectation. What you mean, Pastor, ain't here? Well, I'm not going to be here next week. And you will be graced with the blessings of the Reverend Dr. Karen Stewart. She will be here to preach to you, the First Lady of First Institutional Baptist. So here we are. We had the scenarios. I brought it home to you because we live in this fast-paced, give it to me now society.
Amen.
Where we feel like we are just the Energizer Bunny, where we can just keep going. And what God is explaining, Jesus is explaining to us and pointing out to us very poignantly that there is a necessity,
yes,
for us to step away.
Yes.
To step away. That means turn your phone off. He said a deserted place.
Yes.
That means the phone wasn't there, the email wasn't there, the computer wasn't there. Nothing was there. It was deserted. How many of y'all feel like, oh, I would just lose my mind? I would just lose my mind if I was in a place that quiet. Go off campus and we'll be like, oh my God, it's so quiet. I couldn't sleep last night. Because it's so quiet, but the Lord is calling us to a space.
Yeah. Amen.
Quietness and restoration.
Yes.
We want instantaneous miracles. We are in need of a miracle. We think that we should pray right now, and as soon as we open our eyes, it's there. And then there's some of us who be like, you know, God, I'm reasonable. You don't have to make this miracle happen as soon as I open my eyes, but can you do this by end of day? Our instant gratification culture is a culture that shapes our behavior. We want not just miracles, but instantaneous miracles. We want illness cured and pray for them to be cured now. We want financial difficulties relieved. We buy lottery tickets and hope that all of our difficulties will be relieved instantly. How many of you go, oh man, it's $450 billion, and you sit and you go, man, if I had that money, I'd do this, this, this. But if you think about it, everything that you said you would do does not leave room for rest and restoration.
Amen.
Even when you had the money, you still would not allow ourselves to be rested and restored. We want to lose weight. We want to lose weight, so we go on miracle diets that promises us quick and permanent. Quick and permanent weight loss. We want what we want, and we want it now. Moreover, we want what we want to be bestowed on us with little effort on our part. Little effort on our part. We think we should just be able to pray and ta-da. Little effort on our part. We want all of this with little effort on our parts. These reflections on our instant gratification society may seem a little long way off from the text, but Jesus retreating to a lonely place and his response to the people who came to him for healing, but the distance is not much. The text is divided into two sections. Together they tell us two important things about wholeness. First, we see that Jesus understood the need for regular replenishment and renewal.
Yes.
When the disciples tell Jesus about their travels and teaching, they report that they were surrounded by crowds of people who wanted to be near them and to hear their words. Jesus knew the wear and tear of constantly being available to people. How many of you have been to a concert that doesn't have seats assigned? Right? It's on like a field, and all these people are there, and everywhere you move, you dipping and dodging people from touching you. But it gets hard the larger the venue, or the smaller the venue and the larger the crowd. Right? You can't help but to be touched. And so Jesus and the disciples were having this experience, and Jesus has this experience all the time. And he tells them that they need to rest. As important as ministry is, even Jesus needed to step away to be replenished and for renewal. So he said to his disciples, come away to a deserted place all by yourselves and rest a while. Amen. I've struggled
with the need to take time off throughout my ministry. Now, I'm a second career minister. First career, I took off. I scheduled my days as soon as the year started. I was in the school district, and so you know, every start in September, you get 10 days. Every month, I had a day off. And I can tell you about what time of the month I was taking that day off. And then I could maneuver where I would save days from the last year to run over to the next year. And that was extra day that I could work with when I needed a mental health day. To this day, when I talk to friends from that section of my life, they go, "You remember when you use all your days?" Every year. Yes, I did. Now, what happened that I shift careers into ministry and it's not as easy to take off? It's easy for us to reason that ministry of the church, the work of the office, the volunteer program, the community project will not get done if we take time off. Have you ever stopped to think that such a view of indispensability is idolatrous?
Yes,
that we are so important that even everything depends on us. When we try to fulfill the impossible expectations, we end up frustrated,
yes,
angry,
yes,
depressed,
yes,
and even disillusioned.
Yes.
Only then do we realize that we cannot meet all of the expectations and care for all the needs.
Amen.
If Jesus did that, he needed time for renewal, prayer, meditation, and refreshment.
Yes.
Who do we think we are?
Well.
That we can go on continuing to minister and to work and to serve in his name without replenishment.
All right.
We are. Remember, the culture has coined workaholic.
Yes.
We desperately need to recover the practice of retreat, replenishment, spiritual nurture, and care for our very souls. That's the first thing the text tells us about wholeness. That we need to replenish the springs of our soul. The second thing is that wholeness is not so much dropped on us out of the blue as it is a gift of God to those who believe that God can give it to them. There's a responsibility that we have in receiving wholeness, and it says that we believe that God can give it to us.
Yes.
The text tells us that once people recognized Jesus, they brought their sick to him to be made well. They believed that they would be made whole if they could simply touch the fringes of his cloak.
Yes.
And all who touched were healed. Think of healing in a broad sense as possible, as physical healing, to be sure, but also as a restoration of wholeness. Think of it in terms of healing the body, the mind, the spirit, which represents wholeness. Think of it as healing the past, which frees persons from captivity, from guilt and sin. Think of it as healing the psyche, which releases one from anxiety and restores one to life of trust and confidence. Then ponder the faith of those who anticipated and expected healing if they could simply touch the fringes of Jesus' cloak. In the New Testament, there is a close correlation between the word healing, wholeness, and salvation. To be healed physically, mentally, and spiritually is equivalent to being made whole. It is synonymous to being saved. And Christ is the giver of such healing, wholeness, and salvation to those who believe. But believing is not some kind of magical method of getting what you want from God right now. Rather, it is faith that Christ is the key that can open the door to allow the healing of mind, body, and spirit to come into our lives with strong connection between healing, wholeness, and salvation in the New Testament. We do well to remember that healing is not always, may not always be what we hoped for. We may hope for a physical healing, but healing that comes may be the strength of the spirit and confidence of will to sustain us as we see and see us through the difficulty of a physical illness. There was a woman who was diagnosed with an autoimmune disease at an early age. She knew this disease would not kill her. She felt she would not be limited in what she could do, but she understood that there would be limits in the area of duration, of how long she could do a thing. With the life adjustment, what she knew without a doubt was that God would be her sustainer. What she learned was that she had to take more time to replenish, more time to rest, more time for restoration. God didn't heal her, but he sustained her through the physical illness and the emotional struggles that came along with her condition. Sometimes, like Paul, we have to trust God to sustain us with the thorn in our side. Whether we are healed or sustained, we have to know that God is present with us. In Christ, we can be whole regardless of our circumstances. I think we can say that Jesus knew something important about ministry of wholeness, healing, and salvation. He knew that caregivers must be replenished from time to time. He knew that wholeness comes to those who in faith both expect it and leave it shape to God. If Jesus knew both these things about renewal, belief, and wholeness, shouldn't we take a cue from him? Going, and going doesn't make us better. It wears us out. It distorts our decision making. It makes us angry and irritable and intolerable. Right? We don't tolerate much when we're tired and irritable. We've been working and working and working. We have to remember to take time to rest. Time to replenish, to prioritize retreating, giving ourselves hours and days to be with God and God alone, away in the desert place, right? That might be your prayer closet in your house where you lock the door so the kids can't come in, or so the husband can't ask you questions. But it's important that we set sacred time aside where we say, this is God time, and no matter how much I've done, it's time to stop. Because he's going to be there tomorrow with more. And whether I finish all of this today or not, there's still going to be more tomorrow. So, in order to endure, it's in our best interest to prioritize time away with God in the desert place. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Come on, let's give God praise.
Interpret that
for us.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let us stand together and sing. They'll know we are Christians by our love. The lyrics are in your bulletin. Jesus' name, let us sing the threefold hymn.